The cohort paradigm. If you want to get an intuitive understanding of the use of cohorts in modern healthcare, accountable healthcare analysis, read the book Riddles in Accountable Healthcare, made up of 29 chapters, each of about 3 pages in duration, allows you to develop an intuitive understanding of why the cohort approach is so important. Big healthcare data is useful when you transform it into temporally enriched information. When the information answers an actionable question, when you're willing and actually act upon the result of that question, when the results of that action are detectable, and you have a methodology to evaluate the results, and then you commit to act on the implications of that evaluation. So let's talk about information that is patient value centric and how it differs from business volume centric. So a business volume centric question is, how many admissions happened in 2011? A value question is, how many unique individuals were admitted? That is, there's a big difference between one patient admitted and readmitted 100 times and 100 patients that got whatever needs to be done completed in the first admission and did not get readmitted. A business question might be, how many visits for hypertension? How many fee-for-services you collected? A value question would be, is how long does it take to control hypertension? This patient value question is central to the medical home accountable care paradigm that we're all beginning to accept. A volume question is, how much do we spend on drug X? A value question is, how rapidly did patients improve when on drug X? Let's explore the meaning of a patient-centric cohort. At its most basic level, you can think of a cohort of patients as made up of 2 columns of a spreadsheet. Column number 1 is a medical record number, basically the identifier for the patient. Column number 2 is a date and time. It's called the index date time. It has a special place in the cohort. All analyses will be anchored from this index date time. All measurements of elapsed time to success or failure will start at the index date time. So when you have a group of patients, you need to specify both their medical record number and their index date time. How else might a cohort appear in another view? Well, here's a calendar graph representation of a patient-centric cohort. Over here, you have the passage of calendar time from 1-1-2010 to 1-1-2011. Over here, you have the individual patients and their medical record number identifiers. And here you have the moment when they first appeared into the clinic and declared themselves as diabetics. So you can see over the course of the year, patients presented at different times and said, I'm a diabetic. Members of the cohort are then followed forward in time to some outcome. In this case, a positive outcome of controlling their diabetes, controlling their hemoglobin A1C. And you're expected to be able to evaluate the success or failure of the management of this cohort. Now, for a moment, you should consider, what are those metrics that are usually used to evaluate a cohort of diabetics followed in the year 2010? Most of the time, people think of the HEDA standards. And what the HEDA standards do is they look cross-sectionally in the year 2010 at all the people identified as diabetic, and they ask a simple question, who was brought under control? When you ask that question, you have 4 people under control. And HEDIS would say 40% good, 60% bad. Moreover, HEDIS would identify the ones who are not circled as good as being bad. But take a look at patient number 9. What do you notice? Patient number 9 has a relatively short elapsed time from the time that he declared himself as diabetic to the time that he was brought under control. Unfortunately, patient number 9 came in at the end of the year, so there wasn't enough time to bring him under control. The cross-sectional view, looking just in 2010, declares that patient number 9 is a failure and that his doctor is a failure. But in fact, we intuit that this patient did very well. The problem is, if you accept the cross-sectional view, you are going to inspire doctors not to accept patients at the end of the year, or to draw blood tests at the end of the year because it's just not in their interest. The cohort view of this would recognize that each patient has his own index time, his unique start time. And what we want to actually summarize is not performance in a calendar year, but rather over elapsed time. So what we do here is we just recognize the index date sets a time zero for everybody. This cohort was identified in the year 2010, but their follow-up time for some goes into the year 2011, and we have now as our unit of time, elapsed time, over the course of a year. Now when we ask of those who have been followed for years' time, what percentage of them actually were brought under control, we notice that 5 out of 10 instead of 4 out of 10 are brought under control. And more importantly, for the doctors and the patients, this is an honest representation of how well we're doing and an honest representation of who has to be seen in follow-up, because there had been enough time for the person to get better, but he just didn't get better. For additional reading, I suggest you read Riddles in Accountable Healthcare, A Primer to Develop Analytic Intuition for Medical Homes and Population Health by Aaron Bellin, and pay particular attention to Chapter 8, Am I My Brother's Keeper? The Longitudinal Healthcare Paradigm. The longitudinal healthcare paradigm is in fact the paradigm of medical home, accountable care, and value-based care delivery. And you will find the topics covered in Riddles in Accountable Healthcare quite fascinating and sometimes quite amusing. Thank you for your attention.